and puts them in the realm of pseudoscience if we can't challenge, if it's not falsifiable. You know, Karl Popper's points out in defining good science versus pseudoscience, if it cannot be challenged, if other scientists can't look at it, then it's not good science. But anyway, I wanted to make this point, Gary, so I'm bringing to the floor several points here as we discuss this. But the fact is, nanothermite is a highly sophisticated explosive and could not be made so trivially, particularly back in 2001. It was not made in a cave in Afghanistan, for example, and then shipped over in multi-thousands of pounds or kilos of this explosive material and then carted into the building and applied in the judicious spots to bring these buildings down. That's a very highly sophisticated operation to do all of that. And plus the security in these buildings would have precluded Al-Qaeda from having access. Besides that, why would they, if they put explosives in, why would they then bother with planes? I mean, you know, it's just these people that make such suggestions, I find, haven't thought it through and don't know the difficulty of manufacturing nanothermite, which Kevin Ryan, in his papers and his efforts to make this material, he's a chemist, and it's just very difficult to make this. But there were laboratories, defense contracted laboratories, in 2001 and the years prior that did have this capability. That is true. And therefore, in this investigation that we're calling for, we would insist and subpoena scientists and as well as politicians and others who might be involved. You see, it's interesting, the scientists may not even know what the nanothermitic material was used for. I mean, here they are developing it. That doesn't mean that the leaders, the schemers, are going to tell them all the details of what this material is used for. Certainly they would not disclose that just to a few people. That would then be fully aware of all the uses of this nanothermite as it's found now in the World Trade Center dust. So, okay. So I've tried to lay out the case here that this is more than just Al-Qaeda. This is a highly sophisticated explosive in a highly secure building and secure buildings there in the World Trade Center. These explosives would almost certainly have to be placed in the core columns, according to the work of some of the engineers. And again, I refer to over 1,000 architects and engineers who challenged the official story, and they've helped us then understand where that you have to get at the core columns, which were restricted access, certainly, in these buildings in order to place these very sophisticated devices in the buildings to bring them down in the way that we observe that they fell down. See,
Could you shift over now and give us your feedback on first-person responders, what they saw, what they heard, and why?
Right.
The government, by the way, we're shifting over now from WMYE to GaryNull.com and ProgressiveRadioNetwork.com. So all over the world, those of you who are listening on the Internet, please continue. You can watch this program by going to ProgressiveRadioNetwork.com or GaryNull.com. We are going to continue live right now with our 9/11 panel and Ian Henshall coming up. Now, please continue.
Okay.
Because I was at 9/11.
You were there.
Yeah, I was there. It was rather interesting because I had just flown in that morning.
Yeah.
And I always go for a run on the river north towards the George Washington Bridge.
Uh-huh.
I had never in my life gone south, but that morning I decided to go south.
Uh-huh.
And I was down there when the planes hit, and I was helping people get out of the area. In fact, there was a Secret Service guy who knew me, and he came over and he said, "We got to get people to move because a lot of people initially were leaving the building in a rather casual manner before it started to implode, and we were trying to get people to hustle out of there." In any case, I have heard a lot of people who were there talk about, I didn't, but they talked about listening and hearing explosive, and this is police officers and firefighters and people who are pretty good at being aware of what's going on in any environment. These are emergency individuals. They're used to paying attention. But I want to know what your experience has been in that respect.
Right. Well, I appreciate your experience. And, yes, we do have multiple reports from firefighters and first responders there in the buildings or near the buildings who reported hearing explosions as well as seeing flashes of light that are not consistent with just some sort of gravitational collapse, but are consistent with explosions occurring, as is the nanothermitic material, consistent with explosions occurring in the World Trade Center skyscrapers. So with regard to these reports, I might say that there's an example of firefighters talking about explosions, to begin with. This is in my first paper on 9/11, which you can find at journalof911studies.com, and that's just a that's our journal where papers that have been peer-reviewed are published, and you'll find my initial paper there. It's in the September 2006 volume. We have over 130 papers now, peer-reviewed papers in this journal, as well as in the more established journals such as the Open Chemical Physics Journal and the Open Civil Engineering Journal and so on. The point is that I do have quotes from those who have heard, who did hear explosions occurring in these buildings as they were coming down. In addition, though, you see, to me, that's important. One of the more important eyewitness reports that we have relates to the observation of molten metal. Niels Harrit talked about this. As the South Tower, just before it collapsed, there was molten metal flowing out of the side of the South Tower. And this was admitted to by NIST as well. They did not explain it very well. This is orange in color. They admitted that. And then they said, well, maybe it's just molten airplane aluminum alloy coming out. But the problem with that is then I did experiments, and I showed that molten aluminum alloy, as you melt it and pour it in daylight conditions, which this was, is the morning of 9/11. It was a nice sunny day. Then aluminum appears aluminy. How can I pronounce it? Silvery. Okay. It looks like aluminum metal when it's melted and poured out. It looks silvery. It doesn't have an orange glow to it, which NIST admitted, and you can see in the several videos that we have. So this is an eyewitness report caught on video of molten orange flowing material. And this is totally consistent with a residue from a thermitic reaction in which sulfur probably was also involved. But in any case, molten iron or steel does have this orange appearance. The problem is that the fires in the South Tower, and that's true of the fires in the other buildings, and office fires in general, it's just simply not hot enough to melt iron, not hot enough to melt steel. That requires 2,800 Fahrenheit. Now, the thermitic reaction does produce molten iron, and it occurs at approximately 4,500 plus Fahrenheit. So it's way hot enough to produce molten iron, and it does produce molten iron in the reaction. This we also see copious spheres of molten iron, which means that this is in the dust, little spheres of molten iron, including aluminum, a lot of them. That's a strange mix. Iron, aluminum, and silicon spheres, but this is what you find in the nanothermitic red material. It all fits together. And yet none of it is explained by NIST, and who refuses to look for explosive residue in the dust. it's really almost comical that they would attempt an explanation without at least looking for explosive residues, which they refused to look for. It's just remarkable.